Welcome to Air Checks. I'm your host, Ty Rosenow. In this third hour of Sunday, we will be listening to the Imagination Workshop from KANU Lawrence, Kansas, which is on the University of Kansas. The show lasted from 1985 to 1993 to, and then changed right between the ears in mid-1993. It made its final broadcast as Right Between the Ears in November 18th, 2017, lasting for 32 years. Over the years, the show has been broadcast on National Public Radio, the BBC and Sirius-XM, as well as on Kansas Public Radio stations. Right Between the Ears is a four-time winner of the gold medal as Best Comedy Show at the New York Festivals, twice grabbing the festival's grand prize for Entertainment Programming, broadcasted on March 1993. Here's the Imagination Workshop.
Yes?
Good evening. I'm Bill.
Oh, my God, you're Bill Clinton.
Well, that's right.
Won't you come in?
Well, thank you. Thank you very much.
Oh, this is so incredible. The president right here in my living room. You know, I just love your wife. I think
Thank
the
you.
Work that she is doing on health care reform is wonderful.
Oh, that's nothing. When she's done with that, I'm going to have her figure out why the phone always rings when you're in the shower.
What can I do for you, Mr. President?
Well, Dottie, may I call you Dottie?
Sure.
Dottie, you probably heard about my plan to reduce the deficit.
Yes.
About how we're all going to have to sacrifice and pitch in to get this country out of debt.
Yeah?
I'm here to pick up your contribution.
What?
How much can I put you down for?
Now, wait a minute.
We take Visa, MasterCard...
Wait! I didn't know you were going to come around collecting for it. I thought like it would be a tax increase or something.
We don't have time for a tax increase, Dottie. We got a $4 trillion deficit. Now, what do you say?
Well, I guess we could swing $100.
Dottie, that's not very patriotic.
It's not?
Your neighbors, the Nelsons, contributed $500.
Well, we could never afford
you know,
to give
Dottie,
you...
a tax audit is a very unpleasant thing.
$500? I think we could manage that, sure. Will you take a check?
Sure. We got a $4 trillion
debt. I know. Here.
Oh, you're a real American, Dottie.
I know. I'm flat broke.
Yeah. Well, so long now.
Hey! Hey, honey, who was that?
Well, Bill Clinton.
Yeah, sure. He and Hillary just dropped by to use the toilet, right?
It really was Bill Clinton, Earl.
Yeah, sure. Next thing you'll be telling me is live from Liberty Hall, it's the Imagination Workshop.
Mr. Beelzebub? You bet, Jimmy. Anything you say.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Satan, Lord of the Underworld. You know, when I torment the wicked in the Lake of Fire, I need a high-octane gasoline I can rely on. That's why I always use Phillips 666. It burns with a pungent aroma of sulfur and brimstone, ignites quickly, and thanks to the patented no-noise formula, eliminates that annoying weeping and wailing in the fiery cauldron of eternal despair. Plus, it's got detergent additives for quick, easy cleanup. So take it from Mephistopheles. If Phillips 666 is good enough for me, it sure as hell good enough for your Pontiac. After all, would I lie?
You're all set to go, Mr. Beelzebub.
Thanks, Jimmy. Say, how'd you like to own this gas station? I can fix it for you.
Me? Well, I don't know.
All you have to do is sign here on the dotted line. Think of it, Jimmy. Your own oil company.
Well, I don't know. It's
High Test Ultra from Phillips 666. Use it in your car today. Burn in it for eternity tomorrow.
President Clinton, on behalf of my fellow Republicans, I want to welcome you to the Senate dining room.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Dole. Thank you very much.
We asked you here because we think you ought to get a fair chance to represent your economic plan to the American people.
Thank you.
Before we kick the crap out of it, right, guys?
Okay, but next time I get to pick the restaurant. You know, they got a 49-cent hamburger now over McDonald's.
Mr. President, about your economic program.
What about it, Senator Michael?
I'd like to visit with you for a minute as if we were sitting down over a cup of coffee in my hometown Peoria.
Excuse me, gentlemen. Will there be anything else here?
Just the check, waitress. Give it to the president.
Hey, waitress, come here a minute.
Get your hands off me, you little creep.
Come on, you want it, you know you do. Let me stick my tongue down your throat.
All right, knock it off, Packwood.
As I was saying, Mr. President...
Now, wait a minute. I'd like to pick up this tab, but I'm a little short here.
Well, how short, Mr. President?
About $3.8 trillion. The free lunch is over, boys.
Right, so pay the check.
Well, I can kick in some, but how about if you boys make a contribution, too?
What do you mean, a contribution?
I mean, if we all work together on this thing and make some sacrifices, we can pay off this debt.
Oh, park the dang bus, will you? The campaign's over, Mr. President.
Now, hold on, Senator Graham. We got a $67 tab here. If we divide that up five ways, that's $13.40 apiece, or 20% of the total debt.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if you figure 20% of that total for a tip, that's an extra $13.40.
Huh?
Split five ways, that's $2.68 or 5% apiece, bringing our individual debt to $16.08. Now, that's a fair, equal contribution from everybody.
That dog won't hunt, Mr. President.
Huh?
I only had a dang cheese sandwich, for crying out loud.
Well,
you had the soup, salad, prime rib, and two desserts. If you'd have cut your spending more, you wouldn't need our help now.
Look, I'm just investing in America. We got to grow this economy.
Only thing growing around here is your waistline.
Senator Graham's got a point there.
Yeah, he's got a point, but if he combs his hair the right way, it won't show too bad.
Gentlemen, I'm sure if we sat down over a friendly cup of coffee...
Come on,
we could
Mr.
Bring...
President, you ain't a heck of a lot more than us. We shouldn't have to pay the same as you.
Well, boys, if you're going to nitpick at every little detail of this plan...
I only have the tuna melt and coffee.
And why don't we sit down over a nice hot cup of coffee?
That's $4.95 tops.
The coffee?
No, the tuna melt. Try to follow the conversation, Michael.
Excuse me, gentlemen. Did someone here want coffee?
I'll take some coffee, honey, and a thigh massage. Come here.
Packwood, will you cut it out?
Hey.
Your numbers don't add up, Mr. President. You know it, I know it, and the American people know it.
Mr. President, Mr. President, I'd still like to visit, like we were sitting down over a cup of coffee in my hometown.
Oh, will you knock it off with the coffee in Peoria already? This is serious.
You mean the tax burden caused by the president's economic program?
No, you idiot. Getting stuck with a lunch tab.
Excuse me, Mr. President.
Hey, honey, I'm feeling faint over here. How about some mouth-to-mouth?
Backwood, if you don't knock it off, I'm going to stick this salad fork in your head.
Mr. President!
What is it, waitress?
There's someone here to see you.
I see a lot of people sitting around the table. Nobody's doing a dang thing about this debt.
Oh, no, not him again.
Are we going to talk about it, or are we going to do it?
Go on, beat it out of here, bro.
This debt's like a crazy relative in the basement. Everybody talks about it, but nobody will take out their Visa gold card and buy it a room at the nut farm.
Will you get out of here, please? Come on, get out of here. Run.
Since the beginning of time, man has wrestled with various solutions to the problem of hair loss.
I cover bald spot with dead animal skin. What thinker, woman?
God, look like idiot.
And of course, there was the problem of fleas. In time, man stumbled upon the notion of creating lifelike hair replacements known as toupees.
Look at this, Josephine. This toupee hides my bald spot, no?
Napoléon, mon amour. You look like an idiot.
In fact, as we now know, the word toupee is French for idiot. With the dawn of the 20th century, man drew upon all of civilization's accumulated thought and innovation to develop revolutionary new ways to combat hair loss.
Hey, honey, look, if I comb the hair from the other side of my head over my bald spot, it don't look so bad.
Well, you look like an idiot.
But man was somewhat dissatisfied with the results, and he still looked like an idiot. But now, on the eve of the 21st century, comes the most amazing hair loss remedy in history. From the creators of virtual reality technology now comes virtual hair. The new virtual hair system projects a three-dimensional hair hologram, 1 inch above your scalp. The entire system fits snugly into your shirt pocket. And the 200-pound dry cell battery that powers the system straps comfortably onto your back. Or, if you're a guy on the go, the virtual hair system is also available with a free extension cord that plugs into any AC outlet and allows you up to 50 feet of unrestricted mobility.
Wow, that's for me!
So, if your life is hair today, gone tomorrow, try virtual hair. Check it out before your hair begins to wave. Goodbye.
December 7th, 1941. Somewhere over the Pacific, Captain Rip McGonagall receives top secret orders. Defend Pearl Harbor.
Captain, we're approaching Pearl Harbor.
This is it, men. Battle stations. Rodriguez, O'Hara, man your guns.
Ready, Captain.
Ready, sir.
Any sign of those Jap Zeros?
No, sir. Not yet.
We'll keep a sharp eye out. The sky should be full of them any minute now.
Aye, sir.
That's right. Any minute now. Jap Zeros. Lots of them. Any minute now.
It seems pretty quiet to me, Skipper. You sure it was Pearl Harbor under attack?
It says so in the secret orders. Rodriguez, what time is it?
1300 hours, sir.
What day is it?
July 15, 1951.
Damn it! Late again!
Yes, it's time for another fast-moving episode of Blimp Commando.
All right, men, our work here is done. Pinelli, set course for...
Captain McGonagall, an urgent message arrived by carrier pigeon, sir.
Let me see that, O'Hara. Looks like we're needed elsewhere, men. Pinelli, set course for Korea.
Korea, sir?
You heard me. What's our ETA?
Well, if we really push it...
Yeah?
We ought to be there in about 5 years.
Geez, skipper, what's the point of flying around in this stupid gas bag when we can get there a whole lot faster in a plane?
What? And lose the element of surprise?
Sir, the surprise is always showing up 5 years too late.
Say, who do you think won the war, anyway?
How the heck should I know? We've been stuck in this damn blimp since 1940.
Funny nobody's missed us. O'Hara, put in a call to headquarters.
Sorry, Captain, the radio's been busted since 1947.
What's the matter with your voice?
Nothing.
Sounds like you've been sucking helium.
Not me, sir.
Rodriguez, what do you think?
Definitely sounds like a helium overdose to me, skipper.
Now cut that out! Hey, why can't you guys just smoke reefers like everybody else in the Army Air Corps?
Wait a minute, Captain. If there is a helium on a bridge, we can only be in a willing explanation.
Oh, my God, you mean?
That's right. It means we've developed a leak.
What makes you say that?
Will Captain Rip McGonagall and his crew escape certain death as their airship plunges out of control into the sea? The answer, tune in next time when you'll hear Captain Rip say...
Well, at least we have our dignity.
That's next time on Blimp Commandos. And now, an important message for scholars everywhere.
Hi, I'm Lisa Marie Presley. As you may have heard, I recently gained control of my daddy's estate to the tune of $100 million. Well, it don't take a high school diploma, thank goodness, to figure out that sure is a heap of dough. When I heard about it, I wasn't quite sure what to do with it all. Then I said to myself, Self, you should ought to use your millions to help other people less fortunate than yourself. And then I said to myself, Self? Nah, what am I, crazy? I went out and bought myself a $10 million double-wide mobile home with a solid gold propane tank. A couple of $1 million worth of Nintendo games and 200,000 or 300,000 Holder tubs. Of course, I just blew some of it on worthless junk, too. But then my accountant says to me, he says, Lisa Marie, you better find a tax shelter for that money or Uncle Sammy's going to take all your halter tops away. And that is why I am proud to announce the first annual Lisa Marie Presley Genius Grants. That's right, three $1 million grants. That's a grand total of, $3 million. The money goes to three distinguished thinkers whose work best upholds the high standards of my daddy, Elvis Presley, and who I think are kind of cute. This year's winners are Billy Ray Cyrus, Richard Petty, and former Dukes of Hazzard TV star Tom Wopat. If you'd like to apply for our next round of genius grants, just send a postcard to me, Lisa Marie Presley, care of this station. Oh, and in the unlikely event nobody qualifies for a grant next year, I'm planning to buy the Daytona Motor Speedway and a fleet of monster trucks.
Applications due by April 1st and must be filled out in big block letters. Let Elvis help you be smart.
Wanted to see me, Mr. Hoover?
Yeah. Come in, Inspector Erskine. Lou, you've been with the Bureau for a long time now.
That's right, Mr. Hoover. 19 years.
And I want you to take charge of a very troublesome situation.
Yes, sir. You want me to head up that new anti-communist strike force?
No, I want you to zip me up in the back here.
I beg your pardon?
I can't get this damn dress zipped up in the back.
You doing some undercover work, Chief?
No. Why?
Well, it's just... I mean, I've never seen you like this before.
Oh, you noticed, huh?
It's pretty hard to miss.
How much taller you think I am?
What?
How much taller? These high heels make me look taller, don't they?
High heels, Chief?
Well, they go with a cocktail dress, moron.
Oh, of course.
Now, come on, zip me up, will you? I'm due at the British ambassador's in 20 minutes.
Sure thing. Suck in, Chief.
Watch the hair. Thank you.
Chief, are you sure you want to wear that to the British embassy?
Yeah. Well, maybe you're right, Lou.
You agree, then?
Yeah. It does make me look kind of busty, doesn't it?
Busty?
Hey, I know. I got a cute little chiffon number back there in the closet.
Chief.
What do you think, Lou? Maybe if I wore it without a brassiere.
You're wearing a brassiere, too?
Lou, I know exactly what you're thinking.
You do?
Hell yes. And you're absolutely right.
Well, that's good, because I was...
It's 1968, for Pete's sake. Nobody wears a bra anymore.
Well, that's not exactly what I had...
Come on, help me out of this dress.
Listen, Chief, I gotta ask this.
Toss me that feather boa, will you?
Sure. Chief... What are you doing?
Getting dressed for the British Embassy party. What do you think? Now, come on. Clyde's picking me up in 20 minutes.
I know, but what you're wearing, it's... I don't know.
Pretty damned attractive, huh?
Sir?
You should have seen their eyes bug out when I walked in at the president's birthday party last week.
You wore a dress to the president's birthday party?
Lady Bird was so jealous, she passed out right there on the floor.
Right there on the floor, huh?
And then that wise guy, Averill Harriman, shows up wearing the same damn dress.
You mean Averill Harriman?
Yeah. Can you believe the nerve of that guy?
Chief.
And you should have seen the Joint Chiefs of Staff. For crying out loud, who do they think they are, the Supremes? No wonder we're losing Vietnam.
Mr. Hoover.
Call me Eunice.
Don't you think this might be... Eunice, don't you think this might be a little, you know, dangerous?
Yeah. I know what you're getting at, Lou.
You do?
Look, just because I like to slip into a dress now and then doesn't mean I'm not still a real man. You think these earrings go with this outfit?
Chief! Chief! What if the mob found out? You could be blackmailed.
Yeah, no chance of that, Lou. I got insurance.
Insurance?
I got pictures of Lucky Luciano in a strapless evening gown. Now, listen, tell me the truth now. Would you wear this thing belted?
No way, Chief. Your gut hangs out.
Just a hoot and a holler from Las Vegas. There's a ranch where the air is clean, the views are stunning, and the women will do anything for money. It's the Mustang Ranch, the oldest and most famous brothel in Nevada. But the girls there aren't half as tough as Madame Avery, because she won't take any BS from customers and she won't take American Express cards. So if you want to get spanked by a stranger at the best little bordello in Nevada, show them your backside and show them your Visa card. Visa, it's everywhere. You don't want to be caught.
You're in a life-threatening situation. You've just called Rescue 911, but the lines are busy. What can you do?
Hello, my friend. Rescue 7-Eleven. Is this emergency or takeout order?
Now open 24 hours for your convenience. It's Rescue 7-Eleven.
Hello, Rescue 7-Eleven. Quick, what is your problem? Yes, I see. How far apart are the contractions?
Hey, you have to pay for those pork rinds, my friend!
Our highly trained operators are standing by to take your calls night or day.
Are you sure the leg is broken?
What? Are the Twinkies fresh? They are fresh for 1,000 years, my friend.
Do you have splints at home? No? Then you come here. I give you 2 Slim Jims and a licorice whip.
Yes. Hey, you! Either buy that magazine or get out! This is not public library!
Rescue 7-Eleven is here 7 days a week, 365 days a year.
Cigarettes are $3, also bread, $3. Yes, I'm still here. It is pushed 3 times over the center of the chest, then mouth to mouth once. Yes, quick, quick! Pump number 2 is on!
Rescue 7-Eleven, $2.95 for the first minute, $4 with chili dog. Act now and receive a free call on our new 7-Eleven phone sex line.
Oh, baby, baby, baby. I will send my canoe up your Ganges River. I will melt the dot on your forehead. I will Hindu you till the sacred cows come home. I am your slurpy machine of passion.
All right, give me all your money. And don't give me none of that crap about you can't open the safe after midnight.
If you can't get an honest job, then go back to where you came from.
Rescue 7-Eleven. Over 400 lives saved, over 30 million served.
And thank you for calling the offices of Sally Jesse Raphael. To assist you more easily with your call, please listen to the following menu choices. For an autographed picture of Sally Jesse Raphael, press 2-0. To register a complaint with the show's producers, press 174-2813-9235, umpteen 60, followed by your social security number. And if you would like to be on our television program, press 1. We are pleased that you would like to join Sally on the program. Please listen to the following menu choices, then select the corresponding number that most applies to you. If you are defying your parents and marrying outside of your species, press 1. If you are a woman who has been sexually harassed by Robert Packwood, we're sorry, but that show is already full. If you are a man, but used to be a woman, who was molested by Robert Packwood, press 2. If you have recently seen Elvis, press 3. If you cited Elvis being sexually harassed by Robert Packwood, press 1. If you took a shovel, did some digging, and then you saw Elvis, press 2. If you saw Elvis on board a UFO, press 3. If Elvis and the alien spacecraft appeared to you during the physical act of love, press 1. If your sighting occurred on or near the planet Neptune, press 2. If it happened at Dunkin' Donuts, press 3. Were you hypnotized and then molested in any way? If so, press 1. Was Robert Packwood hypnotized, then molested? Press 2. Wasn't anyone molested? Press 3. Surely somebody was. Press 4. Since your story seems a little flat, could we add a little molestation to it? Press 5. Was J. Edgar Hoover also on the UFO? Was Hoover dressed in a sassy little stretch pants number? Did Hoover's shoes match his bag? Were Elvis and Hoover doing the tango? If Elvis appeared as he did in his 1968 television comeback special, press 1. Due to your last response, we cannot extend an invitation to you at this time. We are sorry, but the producers must maintain the credibility of our show. Thank you for calling.
Well, it's no use. I don't think we're ever going to get on the Sally Jesse Show.
Don't take it so hard, Earthling.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Say any more of those eclairs back here?
No. How about a bear claw?
That sounds good, space boy. All right with you if I go buzz for Aldo's house again?
Okay, by me.
All right. Hit it.
The makers of Eco Burger, the cruelty-free sandwich meat made from suicidally depressed cows, present another dramatic episode of Barbie and Ken at Home. The true-to-life story of America's favorite plastic people and their continuing struggle to wipe that blank, stupid expression off their faces. As today's story opens, Barbie returns home from an important meeting.
Ken, where are you? Get your plastic butt in here.
I'm watching television. What do you want now?
Ken, you'll never believe what the... Ken, you can't watch television.
And why not?
Because that's not a real television, stupid. It's a piece of cardboard painted to look like a television.
You mean I'm watching a cardboard TV?
Yes. But if it'll make you happy, you can still play with the remote control, idiot.
What are you doing home anyway? The mall burned down?
I've just come from Mattel. Listen, we're in big trouble, mister.
Why?
Because they want to make changes. That's why. They say we're not in step with the 90s.
What do you mean? We're both slaves to materialism and we make no significant contribution to humanity. How much more in step could we be?
Listen, stupid, I'm not kidding. You know what they want me to do?
Give up your gold card?
They want me to be more relevant. They want me to be more of a role model.
So?
They want me to take 4 inches off my breasts and add it to my thighs.
Well, better you than me.
Are you kidding? Those are my best parts.
Barbie.
You know what this is leading up to, don't you? Huh? Menopause. Menopausal Barbie. What's next? Help me and I've fallen and I can't get up, Barbie?
Hey. Come on, you can't get up by yourself now.
Well, neither can you.
Oh, come on, lighten up. How bad can it be? Everybody goes through changes. No sense making a federal case about it.
They want you to get a prostate operation.
What? They want me to go under the knife? I'm not even anatomically correct, for God's sake. I don't even have a prostate.
They're gonna put one in. I think it's supposed to be removable or something.
A snap-on prostate? Yeesh.
And that's not the worst part.
You mean it gets worse?
It's my best friend, Midge.
What about her?
She's being discontinued.
Oh, my gosh. Does she know?
Not yet. But she'll be here any minute. Look, Ken, you've got to be the one to tell her.
Me? She's your friend. You tell her.
Oh, I couldn't. I've known Midge all my life. We're like sisters. Besides, I'm taking all her clothes, so I have to go pick them up. That's her now. Please, Ken, do this for me, and I'll make it up to you in bed later.
Great. You know, in some states, it's illegal to go to bed with a plastic woman.
I'll get the door. Oh, look, Ken. It's my best friend, Midge.
Hi, Bambi.
Barbie.
Right.
Just like sisters, huh?
Come in, Midge.
Say, can I use your washing machine? Mine seems to be made of cardboard.
You're just now figuring that out?
It's weird. I have a cardboard toilet, too.
So? We never have to go to the bathroom anyway.
We don't. Since when?
Oh, Midge, listen.
Yes, Bambi?
Barbie.
Right.
Ken has something he wants to tell you.
Barbie?
Well, what is it?
Go ahead, Ken. Tell her.
Well, you see, Midge, there comes a time for all good things must...
Yeah?
Let me put it to you this way, Midge.
Huh?
Okay. Will all the plastic people in the room who haven't been discontinued please raise their hands? Not so fast, Midge.
How will Midge react to this startling news? For the answers, tune in next time when you'll hear Midge say...
But, couldn't I just put my head on one of your old bodies?
That's next time on Barbie and Ken at Home.
Production and distribution of the Imagination Workshop is made possible with funds provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. The Imagination Workshop is a production of KANU, Lawrence, Kansas.
Greek and olive oil.
Oh, why, boy, what a surprise. Come in.
Don't mind if I do. Listen, Olive, there's something I need to talk with you about.
Oh, sit next to me on the love seat, Popeye.
If you insist, get out of here.
Have you come a courting, Popeye?
Court today? No, I've been wanting to tell you something, Olive. Something personal.
Oh, Popeye, something personal? Is it that question I've been longing to hear?
Well,
go ahead, Popeye. Ask me, ask me.
Olive, I have to tell you the truth about myself. You see,
now who could that be?
Well, I don't know.
Olive, where is he? Where's that rat Popeye?
Oh, my gosh, Bluto.
There he is, Popeye. I should have known. I'm going to tear you limb from limb.
Oh, quick, Popeye. Eat your spinach and beat him up.
Bluto, let
Popeye,
me explain.
I'm going to...
What?
I'm going to...
What?
How could you do this to me?
Nothing could happen, Bluto. I never touched her, honest.
Oh, Popeye, go on, eat you. What?
I'm sorry it has to find out this way, Olive. But Bluto and me have been legally recognized as domestic partners.
And we're moving to San Francisco.
Popeye, you spent years beating the crap out of him.
I was only running from me true nature, Olive.
But what am I gonna tell Sweet Pea? He doesn't know if he's a boy or a girl as it is.
Who does?
Think what this'll do to his little psyche.
Don't worry, Olive. I bought Sweet Pea these educational books.
What? What books?
One's called Daddy Shipmate. And the Hardy Boys Come Out.
All right, Popeye. I won't stand in your way. Tell me one thing. Does Wimpy know?
Shiver me timbers, of course he knows. He's moving in with Beetle Bailey. And Cole and Paul for it. I'm out of the closet. I'm Popeye the Sailor Man.
And finally, commentator Bailey White says that there is great personal satisfaction to be found in home canning.
My mama won't eat fresh tomatoes. She says they're full of mercury and pesticides and liable to cause some horrible disease. She swears she read it in the Reader's Digest at the beauty parlor downtown. And being as I'm pushing 70 and she's 95, well, I have to give her credit. Besides which, she's my mama. Well, we grow about 50 dozen bushels of tomatoes in our garden every year, so I have to can all these tomatoes myself. Mama says she gets too tired. Right. I get these big old glass jars out the basement, wash them and sterilize them, and I have to make about 30 trips up and down the basement steps because first I forgot the lids, then I forgot the seals, and... Well, you know, with Mama there encouraging me every step of the way, did you sterilize those jars? You know it's no use putting up tomatoes if the jars ain't sterile. My kids in school have a word for remarks like that. The word they use is duh. As in, duh, Mama. Anyway, when I finally have all the jars and lids and seals laid out like a jigsaw puzzle, then I have to take all these tomatoes and I have to wash each one real careful because Mama's watching my every move, you understand? And last night I killed my mama. Went into her room after she'd fallen asleep watching the Home Shopping Network. Just put a pillow over her face in her sleep. She didn't wiggle a whole lot. It was over pretty fast. I felt a lot better after I did it, especially after I took all them canning jars back down to the basement. Still took me 30 trips, but I was smiling and humming a little tune as I went. You wouldn't believe how many of those little jars it took to get Mama put up. I'm not going to have many jars left to put tomatoes in, which is fine with me because I never liked canned tomatoes that much anyway. I ate a ripe, fresh, raw tomato this afternoon just to spite Mama. Even though she's gone, I can still sense her disapproval. I wear her scorn like a badge of honor. My mama's dead. Long live my mama.
Commentator Bailey White, a former first grade teacher in rural Georgia, is currently being held without bond pending a psychiatric evaluation. Her comments come to us via member station WGSP at the Georgia State Penitentiary in Athens.
There's a small and unassuming building on the west side of Manhattan where the password is secret, the drinks are stiff, and the gambling is illegal. It's Eddie's West Side Joint, a place the cops have been trying to bust for years. But Eddie's is run by the mafia, and they don't take to concealed weapons, and they definitely don't take American Express cards. So if you don't want the hell kicked out of you at Eddie's West Side Joint, shoot to kill and then show them your Visa card. Visa, it's everywhere. You don't want to be caught dead.
He's Jake Hollywood, fired by the LA police for refusing to use excessive force. She's Betty, one tough lady with legs that go on forever. All four of them. Together, they roam the mean streets of Los Angeles as Hollywood and Bovine.
Come on, Betty, they split up. You take the stairs. All right, I'll take the stairs.
There's danger.
Look out, he's got a kettle prod.
Excitement.
Okay, punk. You ready to talk yet?
Yeah, just get this cow off of me.
And useful help tips.
You want some half and half with your coffee, handsome?
No, thanks. I brought my own.
Nobody puts the bad guys out to pasture like Hollywood and Bovine. Coming up later on many of these same stations, Hollywood and Bovine. 98% adventure, 2% milk.
Baby, if you gave bourbon, you'd be great.
If you're like most people, or you're not, and like most people you want to be, because, you know, deep down, who really wants to be different? Too scary, right? You want to be young, slim, sexy. But you're concerned about animal rights, starving in Africa. And you've heard about old people, but you're not really sure you'd ever actually want to meet one. What with the ozone hole, your low self-esteem, and you're not sure, but you think you might have been sexually harassed on a school bus when you was in third grade, and Jimmy Harrison said pee-pee and doo-doo, and can't you sue for that kind of thing nowadays? And for God's sake, they're on you to recycle everything. You know damn well you can't have it all. But who the hell do they think they are telling me where I can smoke and where I can't? This is America, home of the free and the brave, so why the hell aren't I happy? It's my right, and I want my rights now, or I'm going to see my lawyer. So what's a sensible thing to eat in the face of all this light? Yuck, I mean, rainforests burn so they can raise more cattle for more cheeseburgers in Ohio, and I saw a thing on TV where they had this tomato plant hooked up to this machine. And when they brought a knife just a few inches away from its face, its little face, the poor thing just screamed, tore me up. The aura, you know, like the energy field. You know what I'm saying? Like an amputated leg, you still have to scratch it even when you don't have it no more. What I'm trying to tell you, are you listening to me? Here it is. Here it is.
Dirt.
Hmm?
Eat dirt.
Low on the food chain? Hmm? All the minerals fresh? No pesticides, no nothing. Just you and nature. Organic. Happy. Happy. You don't need no fences, no farmers. Dirt. Eat dirt. Because see, you know, the 4-H. 4-H. The future farmers of America and the CIA. They got JFK's head in the deep freeze down there in the what's it triangle thing, Bermuda. Shorts. Huh? You see? And I love Lucy, and I dream of Genie TV signal beaming off into deep space since the 50s up to Alpha Centauri. You with me? Signal to the extraterrestrials. We're dumb down here. Come and kill us now. Orson Bean. Orson Bean. Where are you now when we need you? Orson!
Mr. Clodfelter, Mr. Clodfelter, just calm down.
What do you want, nurse?
It's time for your medication. Now come along quietly.
Listen, the government wants to shut me up because I know. About the flying saucer buried under the Washington Monument, they're beaming radiation into my head. They're trying to get you now. They're gonna get you!
Hey, America, hold on to your seats. It's time again for Celebrity Wedgies. Celebrity Wedgies, the show that proves what goes up doesn't necessarily come down. Brought to you by Fruit of the Loom. Remember, a wedgie doesn't mean doom when it's Fruit of the Loom. Now, here's your host, Skid Marks.
Hey! Hi, everyone, and welcome to Celebrity Wedgies, the show where your favorite celebrities get the wool pulled up and over their eyes. All right, let's get going and join Howie Strayer in Hollywood for tonight's first surprise wedgie.
Thanks, Skid. We're here in Rancho Palos Verdes Nachos de Wembley Uno Frittata, near Hollywood, where every day at this time, a certain celebrity takes his morning jog. When here he comes now. Excuse me, Tom Cruise. Yeah. I'm Mr. Cruise.
What are you doing? Looks like Tom's gone from Rain Man to Pain Man, Howie. He should show that much emotion in his films. Okay, now let's join Eve Summers somewhere in Connecticut, where she's convinced Katharine Hepburn that she's only there to do an interview. Let's watch.
So I said to Spencer...
Excuse me, Miss Hepburn, I think I dropped my pen. Could you reach over there and pick it up, please?
Why, certainly, dear. Oh, what the hell are you...
Wow! She must have gone 4 feet off the ground on that one. All right, let's go to Washington, D.C., where our man Carl Hill is lying in wait for some really big game. Carl?
Man, big game it is, Skid. I see him rounding the corner with Secret Service agents in tow. This is going to take time. Keep the cameras rolling, guys.
Mr. President?
Yeah.
Mr. President?
Yeah, hey, who are you?
Oh, my God, they went to the president. Get that guy.
Oh, boy, that was great. Did you see that bodyguard try to take that wedgie for the president? Okay.
We got him. Hey, get him in the car. Hey, what's... Get him.
Somebody
get the president.
Move it. We need to cover.
Well, looks like Carl has a little explaining to do. Well, that's all the time we have for today for Celebrity Wedgies, but we'll be back next week when our entire show is devoted to William Conrad. Till then, so long!
For a Mahjong tournament in Venezuela when tragedy struck. Stranded in the high Andes without food or water, There was only one thing left to do.
Hey, kids, let's put on a show!
Things look swell, things look great. Gonna have your left foot on a plate. Starting here, starting now. Honey, everyone's coming up frozen.
Yes, it's Alive, the musical. 16 high-spirited guys and gals sing and dance their legs off in this wonderful story of friendship and cannibalism.
Consider yourself orders. Consider your brains part of the pasta course. We don't want to have no fuss. So after lots of mastication, we may state, consider yourself part of us.
Enjoy forgettable song hits like I Baked Your Heart in Saffron Crisco. What Kind of Food Am I? People Who Eat People. And Strangers on My Knife.
There's no people like snow people to eat when you are cold. Yesterday they told you you'd be dead and gone. Today you're eating your best friend Juan. Tomorrow it's a sandwich of his brother Don. Let's get out of the snow.
Alive, the musical. They'll touch your heart and your liver and kidneys too. Alive, the musical. Coming soon to a frozen food counter near you.
Let's get out of the snow.
There's a quaint little shack on the docks in Amsterdam where the seagulls sing, people don't want to get involved, and the merchandise is stolen. It's enter at your own risk, and the men there would just as soon slit your throat as look at you. Even the Port Authority won't go near the place because it's just too dangerous. But it's the place to go if you want the best price on goods that are just off the boat. But be prepared for a strip search and sex with a man they call Smiling Jack. Because they don't take crap from anyone and they don't take American Express cards. Matter of fact, they don't even take Visa. And if you flash anything but cash, just hope the tide brings your body in later and you're not too bloated for your next of kin to recognize you. Visa. It's really not anywhere close to where you want to be.
And now, another adventure torn from the casebook of Mobile Holmes.
Amazing, Holmes.
Elementary, my dear Flotsam.
You have proven irrefutably that Holy Peter's murdered the Duke, stole the Smythe Jurium submarine plans, and still had time to remove his own appendix with a paring knife.
You're certain the appendix is on the left side, Flotsam?
Of course. What kind of thicky do you think I am, old man?
The same thicky who once tried to remove a man's tonsils by going in through his foot with a soup spoon. Come in.
Ah, Mrs. Stickleback, it's you.
No, it's the Countess of Codswallop, your great nattering twit.
Oh, forgive me, Your Grace. You look just like our landlady, Mrs. Stickle...
Never mind, Flotsam.
Back.
What do you want, Mrs. Hatchetface?
Inspector Tarnybrain of Scotland Yard is here to see you, Mr. Holmes.
Surely you mean Inspector Lestrange, Mrs. Cabbage Breath?
If you say so, Mr. Holmes. In here, shag nasty!
Damned insolent woman. If she was mine, I'd poison her.
If I was yours, I'd poison myself.
What do you want, Lestrange?
Well, it's an awkward business, Mr. Holmes. Damned awkward indeed.
What's the crisis, then?
I can't remember, Mr. Holmes. That's what's so damned awkward about it. Now, I knew it when I left the yard. I wrote it down so as I wouldn't forget.
Yes?
But I can't read.
Lestrange... You are doubtless the most addle-pated cretin in all London.
I say, Holmes, perhaps he's suffering from magnesia.
Make that the second most addle-pated cretin in all London.
Wait, I just remembered, Mr. Holmes. Roderick Whipsnade, the eminent dentist, has been murdered. Will you come?
Of course. I'll get my coat. Flotsam!
Yes, Holmes.
Grab my fedora.
Wouldn't that be a tad unseemly, Holmes? I mean, in front of Lestrange and all. We just should keep it a little between ourselves.
So, General Whipsnade, why would someone wish to murder your brother?
He was a strange one, was Reginald.
I believe his name was Roderick, General Whipsnade.
Really, you sure about that, are you?
I take it you weren't close.
With whom?
Your brother.
You mean Renfrew?
Roderick.
Quite right, sir, my brother, you say?
Yes!
Must look him up sometime. Don't have his address, do you?
We're standing in his surgery, General.
We are? Is he about? Renfrew! Yoo-hoo, come out and give us a kiss, old man!
Oh, this is hopeless. Flotsam, perhaps you should take over. You speak fool.
Right you are, Holmes. I say, General.
Yes.
Did your brother have any enemies?
Of course he did. Mm. Nothing like a good enema to loosen up.
All right. Never mind.
You know, Holmes, I once saw Dr. Whipsnade for a root canal.
A root canal, Flotsam?
Yes, but I lost my nerve.
Flotsam.
As I recall, his favorite song was "The Yanks Are Coming." Get it?
Flotsam.
How was Dr. Whipsnade murdered, anyway?
He was drowned in a barrel of varnish.
Varnish, eh? Well, at least he had a good finish. Get it? Good finish, old boy.
Well, I guess we polished that off.
What a wit. I should be on the stage.
I agree, Flotsam. There's one leaving at 3.
Steady on. No need to be so biting.
Oh, sorry, did I hurt your feelings?
Well,
tell the truth now.
That's water under the bridge, Holmes.
Enough of this jiggery-pokery.
Yes.
I've no time for such twaddle.
You'll have plenty of time for jiggery-pokery, General, in your prison cell.
What?
Steady on.
You murdered your brother, Randolph.
Reginald
Renfrew.
Whatever.
But why, Holmes?
Dr. Whipsnade was the world's foremost collector of Babylonian relics. His brother coveted the priceless jeweled ziggurat of Islamabad.
All right, it's true. I searched the world for that ziggurat. I searched. It's mine, and I'm taking it.
Good God, Holmes, he's got a gun.
Out of my way, or you'll end up like my brother, Rookfoot.
Roderick!
Whatever. The ziggurat is coming with me.
I say, is that smoke coming?
Quiet, Flotsam.
Good day, gentlemen.
Holmes, why did you let me get... Great heavens! What was that?
Roderick feared his brother might steal the ziggurat, so he booby-trapped it.
Booby-trapped?
That smoke you saw was the fuse burning. I fear this has ended the general's search for good.
You mean...
Yes, Flotsam. The searching general has proven that smoking ziggurats can be hazardous to your health.
Imagination Workshop is Gene Carr, Paul Friedman, David Greisel, Paul Meyer, Margie Poston, Roberta Solomon, and Rick Tamblyn. Written by Daryl Brogdon with Jeff Bailey and Marty Golia, Raleigh Drennan, Paul Giles and Nick Syracuse, David Greisel, Paul Meyer, Margie Poston, Gary Rafferty, and Rick Tamblyn. Music by Bill Crahan with Jody Larkin. Broadcast engineers are Sam Chapman, Brian Copeland, Rob Klotz, Bob Pearson, and Jason Sloat. Live sound effects performed by Mary Ellen Cree. Production assistance by Rachel Hunter. The Imagination Workshop is produced by Daryl Brogdon. Portions of this show were pre-recorded, and the rest we just made up as we went along. I'm Howard. Please don't hold me responsible for any of this. Hill saying, so long for the Imagination Workshop.
The Imagination Workshop's Greatest Bits is a one-hour audio cassette featuring memorable moments from the workshop's 1992 season, the casebook of mobile homes, Barbie and Ken at home, wacky commercials, and lots of Campaign 92 fun. It's some of our greatest bits. And to receive yours, send $10 plus $1.50 for postage and handling to the Imagination Workshop, care of KANU Radio, the University of Kansas, Lawrence, Kansas, 66045.
Production and distribution of the Imagination Workshop is made possible with funds provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
The Imagination Workshop is a production of KANU Lawrence.
That was the Imagination Workshop, broadcasted for March 1993 by KANU in Lawrence, Kansas, on March 1993. The show was actually a monthly program, so that was kind of neat to listen to when the tapes came in from radio station to radio station. Well, that's it for this Sunday's edition for Air Checks. I'm your host, Ty Rosenow, and we'll have more coming up as we upload every Saturday and Sunday in one-hour increments for 3 hours. Saturday and 3 hours on Sunday. I'm your host, Ty Rosenow, for Air Checks. See you same time at the same channel.